Hello guys, this is about the karyotypes, and this is unit 3 and the first and this is the second video of the unit 3, second lecture of unit 3. It's about the karyotypes. Now, what is a karyotype? A karyotype is the characteristic chromosome complement of a eukaryotic species. So it's difficult to learn what is karyotyping by reading this definition, but actually karyotype denotes the number and the appearance of chromosome inside the nucleus of an eukaryotic cell. So how the chromosomes are arranged and how the chromosomes are present, that means the number of the chromosomes and their appearance, how they are presented inside the nucleus of eukaryotic cell, that's what karyotype says us. Okay, now karyotypes are varying from one type of species to another type of species. That means we are varying the different in different eukaryotic cells. We are varying in the number of chromosomes, we are varying in the arrangement of different chromosomes, and so on. So sometimes the study of these karyotypes are also called the karyology, and this karyology will help us to understand the arrangement of chromosomes inside different cells. And utilizing this knowledge, we can gather information about the perfectly organized chromosomal orientation. So any kind of mistakes among this orientation can lead up to the chromosomal aberrations. So we can pick the chromosomal aberrations by look at the karyotypes of different individuals. Okay, so that's why karyotypes are important. And we actually visualize these karyotypes under microscope, not very much magnification, but you can visualize the chromosome because they are dense in structure. So let's move on. So this is a karyotype of human male. So you can find in case of human males, it is actually double set of chromosomes in each case. So that's why human males are called the diploids, okay, or diploid type of organisms. So there are two different types of organisms in planet. One is the diploid types. These are called the 2N type. N is the number of chromosome, number of sets. So it's a 1 into 2. That means 2 sets of chromosome. That's why you call it 2N number or diploid types of chromosome in case of humans. We are having other different organisms which are also having this diploid sets of chromosome. But also there are some organisms which are having only one set of chromosome. We call them the haploid type of organisms or N type of organism. Now what happens in case of humans, if you look at the somatic cells, that means the cells that makes our whole body, those are the somatic cells but not produce offsprings. So those cells are diploid in orientation. That means they are having two sets of these chromosomes in each orientation. Each of the chromosomal set is derived from one parent. So when the daughter is formed, daughter or boy, whatever, is formed from the parents, one of these chromosome is coming from the father, another one is coming from the mother. So that's why we are having two sets. So that's why it's called the 2N or diploid number of chromosomes. But in germline cells or sex cells inside our body, which will finally produce the gamete for the fusion and producing zygotes, then those gametes are having only N number of chromosomes. So we call them haploid types of cells. Okay, so that's it. Now in case of humans, what we can find, we are having 22 sets of chromosomes. These are the autosomes. That means the body chromosomes are autosomes. So 22 sets, so 22 into 2, as we are having 2N numbers, so 22 into 2, 44. And we are having another set of chromosome, which is slightly different from other ones. Not slightly, actually, we have very distantly related from this chromosome. So this is totally different one, XY or XX, whatever it could be. So it is totally different types of chromosome, because this chromosome denotes or indicates what kind of gender a person is going to have, whether he is going to be a male or is going to be a female. Now if it consists of XX, two X chromosomes, it will results in female. And if it consists of one X and one Y, it will produce only male. So that's how the whole process is actually working. Now the production of this XX and XY will depend upon the probability of shuffling between the sets of chromosome from the father and mother. Suppose father, as father is a male, so it is having X and Y. Mother is female, so it is having XX. Now the combination says us that if it combines in this way, one X from father, one from mother, then it will produce a daughter with XX. if one y from father, another x from mother, so then it will produce xy, which is denoting a boy. So it will totally depend upon the shuffling of the chromosomes and shuffling of the segregation of this chromosome during the gamete formation, and then the fusion of those gametes, and finally produce this kind of karyotypes. Now these karyotypes are important because you can learn in all these cases, in all the 22 autosomes we are having two sets of chromosomes, and you can see a particular length of the chromosomes. So in this third number chromosome, this set is really longer, so it's sky-like structure, and in Y chromosome it is very very dwarf chromosome, very small chromosome. In 22 is also smaller, 21 is smaller, 20 is smaller, so these chromosomes are smaller. And you can see 1, 2, 3, these chromosomes are larger one. So everything is arranged because inside the chromosomes we are having the DNAs, which are carrying all the informations to pass on to the next generation, which is the blueprint of life. So everything is important in each of the steps. Okay. So any problem or any change in these chromosomal numbers can lead up to the devastating effects. For example, if somewhere the chromosome, an extra chromosome added, or sometimes the chromosome is deleted, it will lead up to the very very dangerous effects, what we actually call the chromosomal aberrations. Now we are going to see some of the chromosomal aberrations next time. So if you look at the human female, so this one is a human male, that because we are having X and Y here. In case of female, we are having XX, so 2X, but no Y chromosome is there, that's why it is producing the female instead of male, because this Y chromosome is producing some of the important functionality, some of the important proteins or some hormones and whatever that will eventually produces the characteristics that eventually denotes that it is in male, not female. On the other hand, 2X in case of female can produce different types of phenotypes. Now this 2X, you must have a question that this 2X, whether this 2X or 2 sets are different or not or same. The answer is similar, it's almost similar, because one is coming from father, one is from mother. So it's not mean that both of them coming from mother, one is from mother, one is from father, this thing remains constant. But what varies in this case, that one X only needed, because it is having the same type of chromosome. So this is another very important concept, that in any kind of set of chromosomes, this one and this ones are identical, because the number of genes are present are almost same, the type of genes are present are almost same in all these cases. Okay, sometimes it is varying in slightly differences, because slight variations can be found in case of different human beings, because no two human beings are totally identical. This is also true, but most of the time these are similar, very very similar. So in X chromosome, what we are having 2X, so we don't need the functionality of duplication of chromosome, duplication of a gene, because we need only one set of gene and it will be fine. So one of these X chromosome is active and one of these X will be inactivated. So only one X will be activated at a time. That's another important concept about the human female karyotype. Now, if you look at the human gametes, instead of total 2N number of chromosomes or zygotic chromosomes, if you look at gametes, you can find here that it will consist of only one set of chromosomes, because it is n number chromosome, is haploid types of cell, and this cell will contain again 23 number of chromosomes, not 46, 23. So either it will contain one X or it will contain one Y. Okay, it will depend upon the segregation, what type of segregation is going on. Okay, now let us look at some of the aberrations of chromosomes and how we can pick these aberrations by looking at the karyotypes of human being. Now here you can see the karyotyping, and in the Down syndrome, what is actually happening, we are having an extra set of chromosome at the 21st position. So this is an extra set of chromosome at 21st position, and as a result of this extra set of chromosomal presence, it will change our karyotyping, it will change the behavior of this offspring, and it will change its effect. So, and it will change its phenotype expression too. So that's why it will lead up to some dangerous effects, sometimes very bad effects, sometimes it can lead up to the death of the individuals, most of the time in fact. And two types of aberrations can be seen. One type of aberration can be seen in case of this autosomal chromosome, that means from the chromosome number 1 to chromosome number 22. Down syndrome is a type of autosomal aberration. Now sex chromosomal aberration can also be found if suppose 1X is extra or 1X is deleted, 1Y is extra, with excess. So this kind of problems will be much more difficult, because any kind of problem regarding sex will be very, very questioning in our society. So these are very, very humiliating diseases actually. Now, in case of Klinefelter syndrome, what happens actually, you can see it is a sex chromosomal aberration, because we are having 2X, so we don't need Y. It would produce a perfect normal female, but instead of only 2X, we are also having a Y. As a result of that, we are having a blending of the characteristics between a female and a male in same organism or in same human being. As a result, it can produce some dangerous effects and very, very bad. What you can see, it's a very bad kind of disease, very humiliating kind of diseases. In Turner syndrome, what happens? We are having only 1X, so no second X is there. We have talked before that we need only 1X, because most of the time we are depending upon 1X, but we must have access to another X, because inactivated, but still we need the presence of another X, because sometimes some genes are silent in 1X. So those will be expressed by another X chromosome. So this is not happening in case of Turner syndrome. So that's why it can produce again a dangerous effect in this case. And if I am questioning you that what is wrong about this karyotyping, by looking at this karyotyping, we can say that yes, in this 18 number chromosome, we are having an extra chromosome. Now this extra set of chromosome can lead up to dangerous effects. So not everything is balanced actually in our body. One or two things are too extra or too less can create problem. So that's why we need to be very, very careful in all the situations. So actually these things is actually not in our hands, because this whole thing is happening during the gamete production, and this is the fusion of the gametes. So it's a post zygotic, or sometimes some of the amount is a pre-zygotic process. So these things are not in our hand, but nowadays we can karyotype this whole system before the birth of the baby. But the question is the ethical value of science. That the question is that we can do this, but should we do this or not? Because suppose a baby is in the womb of a mother, then you can karyotype of this baby, you can produce the karyotype, you can see something like that. Now what we can do probably, what we can possibly do, what we can make a possible difference. So this is a question to humanity nowadays. So we are having the techniques, we can know, we can learn, but utilize this technique to prevent the disease before happening, but not to take any responsibility after this kind of disease. So its ethical value is much more higher in this field of biology still now. So emotions are going on all the times, because we are human beings, we think of different things with our emotion. So we need to be very careful about understanding and utilizing the techniques to get this kind of results. This is an example of dog karyotyping. In case of dog karyotyping, we are having 38 autosomal chromosomes and 1X and Y. So it's a male dog, as in this. This is dog is also a XY type of sex determining organism. There are different organisms which are having different way of sex determination. In case of us and dog, we are having XY type. Some in other cases we have different types of divisions. Okay, now you can go back to my channel. I can find videos where you can find the different ways of determining sex. Okay, so this is a mouse karyotyping, and in mouse you can see it's consisting of only 19 autosomal chromosomes and 1XY. Okay, so totally 40 types of chromosomes, 40 number of chromosomes. Okay, now you can find the diploid chromosome number here. Diploid chromosome number means after multiplying the n into 2, these are the results. Okay, so total number of chromosomes. So buffalo have 60, cat 38, cattle 60, dog 78, donkey 62, goat 60, and this is how we go on. But another thing you can see by looking at this, the human are having 46. The number of chromosome definitely does not indicate that the type of the number of chromosome is actually not denoting the superiority of the organism, right? Because cat, buffalo, dog, they are having higher number of chromosomes than us, but still we are superior indeed. So chromosome number does not depict that. Sometimes very few amount of chromosome can be present, but that chromosome will help them to do establish a magnificent work that higher number of chromosome containing organisms can be achieved. Okay, so that's why these things is are also important, that number of chromosome or number of genes does not depict the type or the complexity of the organism. This is also called the C value paradox. If you want to know more about C value paradox, you can Google it, or you can look at the video in my website too. So this is also an important thing I must tell before closing this chapter. I hope it will help you about the karyotyping. Now you can utilize the karyotyping for understanding the type of chromosome that are present and their orientations, their organizations, and also you can utilize them for picking up the diseases or aberrations or chromosomal aberrations. Okay, so that's it. I hope it will help you.